International. Hello again and welcome to the second hour of this morning, the Sunday edition. I'm Michael Enright. In a little while, we'll hear from a Canadian in Kosovo on the small absurdities and serious difficulties of getting through the winter in that tormented part of the world. But first, though, something extra special. A broadcasting legend. Once upon a time in the land of radio, there was a golden age, a time when the restless noises of a turbulent world came to us in our living rooms via the humble vacuum-tubed radio receiver. And one of the creators, one of the artificers of that golden age was a man named Norman Corwin, who realized years before television that radio was all about pictures. Mention the name Norman Corwin today in some media circles and you might be met with a polite stare. But in the 30s and 40s, his name and his work were as well known, almost, as somebody named Roosevelt. He was a writer, a producer, a creator of radio magic, and the director of some of the biggest names in show business. Orson Welles, James Stewart, Lionel Barrymore, Groucho Marx. At any one time, a Norman Corwin production might be listened to by as many as 60 million Americans. His credits fill pages and run from an Oscar nomination for screenwriting to a Peabody Award for broadcasting excellence. His more than 200 original radio plays constitute a living history of the medium of radio. Mr. Corwin is a few months shy of 90 now. He lives and teaches in Southern California. And a couple of weeks ago, his Memos to a New Millennium, narrated by Walter Cronkite, was broadcast on National Public Radio in the United States. This morning, I'm delighted to have Norman Corwin as my guest from an NPR studio in Los Angeles. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
As you came into the studio a few moments ago, I'm trying to visualize you sitting there with the headphones on and doing the voice checks and so on. Does it still have some magic for you after 60 years of radio?
The magic is undiminished. From the very first time I heard anything coming over radio, which was Morse code, by the way.
Really?
I was delighted out of my socks. And I still marvel at the magic of being able to speak in a quiet room or in a closet to millions of people.
How many radios do you own?
I probably have five or six various characters, portable, shortwave, and some with the kind of sophistication and grandeur of a Willits organ.
Scattered around the house, no doubt.
Right.
I think we should explain what the radio environment was in the 30s and 40s. Radio was it, wasn't it? There were the movies, of course, and the Sunday funnies, but radio was the big medium.
Radio was front and center, yes. It was ubiquitous. It was with you everywhere, thanks to the portable radio. And it had not quite reached the proportions of on-street listening that you get from the Walkman today. But it was a ships at sea and everything on land and in air.
And everybody listened.
Yes, yes, they were loud. You see, it had no distraction. It had no competition from the what is now the junior electronic broadcast medium, which is television.
At the CBC, we call it the junior service, of course.
You know, if I may call you Michael.
I would be honored.
There is one thing about radio that strikes me today as singular, that there was no term in radio equivalent to the boob tube or the couch potato.
You're right. You're absolutely right.
And that's because the radio listener participates. He sets, if he's listening to a drama, he's the set designer, he's the wardrobe mistress or master. He imagines the features of the and the weight and the tonnage of the soprano or the contralto singing Carmen. She can weigh 300 pounds, but to the listener, she's beautiful and petite and dangerous.
Dangerous. That, I think that might sum up a lot of the Corwin magic. In the course of our conversation, I want to play some excerpts from some of your best, better-known work. The piece coming up, I want you to listen to with me. It has been called your greatest radio piece, On a Note of Triumph. It aired live, if our listeners can believe this, live on Victory in Europe, or VE Day, May the 8th, 1945, on CBS. I just want to play a little bit of it now, On a Note of Triumph.
It's top of the evening. Hip, hip, hooray. How about another drink, Alf? And a very good time is being had by all. Meanwhile, the crowds gather. Crowds in Times Square, Piccadilly, Nevsky Prospect. Crowds in the Loop, crowds on the Boulevard. Gaiety and neon, laughter and the blare of horns. Headlines cheerful as a Christmas poster. Noise and glitter. This is it, kid. This is the day. This is what we've been waiting for. But through the din, the clamor, do you hear a voice? In the hearing of your conscience, don't you get a whisper? Listen. Listen. Nothing yet, just crowd, but listen close. Take your good ear out of low range. Whisk it high. Hoist it up to Ciro Stratus country, up to where a B-29 has wing room. Flash across a dark Atlantic heaving under the sway of a Victus moon. Listen for intimations of wind and water and a rush of fog eastward of the Grand Banks. Below these waters, strewn beneath the plains of porpoise and whale, the bones of how many good men lie. But never mind, running as we are eastward against the grain of time, we are over the isles in a hop and a jump. We are established now on the continent. So listen closely. In just a moment now. Don't expect to hear metallic speech from a rosette of amplifying horns on the high poles of the public address system. But listen for a modest voice, as sensible and intimate to you as the quiet turning of your own considered judgment. Now we're ready. The voice you hear will be that of the conqueror, the man of the hour, the man of the year, of the past 10 years and the next 20.
I'm a private first class in an army of one of the United Nations. If you don't mind, there's some things I'd like to ask.
Just a man in uniform you've met somewhere, or seen in the newsreels loading a truck, or marching, or read about in the dispatches. A fighting man, glad to be alive. A little tired, but in good shape. A dozen battles notched in his gun stock and dug in his memory. Who is he? Well, his name and rank and nationality don't matter much. Just picture him where he may be tonight in Europe. Perhaps in his cot in a barracks, his hands behind his head thinking things over. Perhaps he's standing on a village green before a monument to the dead of World War I. Perhaps he's strolling in a history-weary valley under the same stars which 2,500 years ago watched a Persian brand of Nazis take a beating in the hills of Marathon. Close your eyes. And it could reasonably be this boy, that boy, any boy at all with war still thumping in his ears. Close your eyes and concentrate and listen.
If you don't mind, there's some things we guys would like to ask. First of all, who did we beat?
How much did it cost to beat him? What have we learned? What do we know now that we didn't know before?
What do we do now? Is it all going to happen again?
Can it be? In the interim between the making of a toast and the drinking of it, such questions on the lips of fighting men tonight?
That was an excerpt from On a Note of Triumph, written, directed, and produced by my guest this morning, Norman Corwin. It was broadcast live on VE Day, May the 8th, 1945. Martin Gable was the narrator, and the original music was composed by Bernard Herrmann, who later went on to score a number of Alfred Hitchcock movies. Now, that was all done in the studio, full orchestra, actors, everything, right there, live.
That was done live, yes.
How did you manage to orchestrate that many people with the technology that you had of the day?
Well, the technology of the day was sufficient. There was something very dynamic and electric about doing a live broadcast. Today, of course, production is done in, as movies are assembled, in takes and then assembled later in post-production, and sometimes that process can go on for 2 weeks. But then it was like a stage play. It was a live performance before a living audience. And you mentioned Bernard Herrmann, and I'm grateful to you for doing that, because even in that excerpt, you could see the power of this composer.
Yeah.
He, by the way, did not only the Hitchcock pictures, as you mentioned, but he also was the composer for Citizen Kane. And by the way, may I congratulate you and thank you for that selection, because in the reminiscences and the replays that this particular program has enjoyed over the years, it's now over 50 years, it's the first time that section was selected. I'm happy about that, because that selection sets up the premise and the promise of the program.
Well, that's thanks to our producer, Meredith Levine, who picked it out. I want to ask about that, because there's something in the writing that I think is quite extraordinary. Now, remembering that it was VE Day, and we had just come through the awful war, the questions that are raised in On a Note of Triumph really boil down to, what was that all about, and was it all worth it? Now, wasn't that a rather dangerous thing to raise on the day of victory around the world?
I never thought that it might be dangerous. I must confess that it wasn't easy to get a handle on this subject. When CBS asked me to interrupt a series that I was then doing to prepare this program to be ready on the air with an hour's broadcast in prime time on the day of victory in Europe, they had no recommendation as to how to approach it. Nobody offered any suggestion of any kind. It was left up to me, and it wasn't easy. I had to seek some handle. What do you say about a victory that is only a partial victory, because
right,
the war went on? We had to deal with Japan, a formidable foe, and nobody knew at that time that the atom bomb was in the wings.
Right.
It was all secret. I knew there would not be dancing in the streets, there would not be celebration or rejoicing, so it had to be a thoughtful program. It could not be a flag-waving, dancing, hip hip hooray program.
But you brought it down to the level of the GI, didn't you?
The
Bill Mauldin kind of character.
He was the common denominator. He was the essence of the war.
Uh-huh.
The man in the trenches, the man with the gun, the killer and the defender. And I sought inspiration. I went to the museums. I listened to music. I read. And finally, one day, I came across a line in a poem by Walt Whitman that gave me my start. And the line was a simple line that he wrote in a poem following the end of the American Civil War. And that was, "Never were such sharp questions asked as on this day." And I thought, yeah, that's the answer. Yeah. To ask questions, because questions are on everybody's mind. And so it was not particularly an act of courage to take this approach. It was, I felt at the time, a necessity.
Well, if your masters at CBS left you alone before the broadcast, how did they respond in the days following when they heard it?
Well, I blush to answer that.
Go ahead. No one can see you. It's radio, Mr. Corwin.
Right. They almost declared a holiday. I was on the West Coast where this program originated, and in New York, there was a general memorandum to the entire organization that between 3 and 4 that afternoon, work would stop, and those who had not heard the program could listen to it piped into their offices. Wow. They made that much of a thing of it. It was a book. And that book, for the first time and only time in my life, I've been writing books too, for the first time and only time in my life, I was on a bestseller list.
You said that you first came to know radio with Morse code, because that was in Boston where you grew up, was it?
That's right.
When did you first begin to understand the possibilities of the medium? Because there were a lot of comedies on, I guess, Amos and Andy and all of that, but your particular style, when did you first get a hint of that you might be able to stretch the medium in some way?
The style evolved after I got going in the medium, but I must say that thrill, that sense of magic, which I experienced when I first heard Morse code on a neighbor's crystal set, remained. I consider radio time I'd have the same regard for it as I'm sure that Johann Sebastian Bach, not to be too grand in my illusions, but Bach had when he thought of the organ. And when a muralist, the kind of excitement that a muralist has when he confronts a blank wall on which he's going to create. And I think a half hour or an hour of God's time on radio is something very precious. And I wanted to make use of it. It was a romantic notion, a sentimental notion, I concede. But it was a notion, and I had it, and I lived by it, and I enjoyed it.
One of those notions that you had was Norman Corwin's Words Without Music. Now, this was, I guess, one of your first real opportunities to be truly inventive with radio, with the medium. Tell me about that series.
Well, I am perhaps the only radio craftsman ever to arrive at a portfolio on a network through poetry. I proposed to the program manager of the network a program in which I would orchestrate and dramatize poetry. And poetry, up to that time, certainly in this country, was considered rather rare and exotic, and by he-men as a little sissified. Whether you're talking about the poetry of Shakespeare or Shelley or Keats, didn't matter. It was poetry, and you expected the advocate of poetry and the reader of poetry and the writer of poetry to be long-haired and a little peculiar. But I brought it into the living room. I dramatized it. I gave it a little life. I took liberties, never violating the spirit or the intent or the actual text, but adding to it and giving it flesh.
Now, what was the response of the audience?
And, I got letters from English teachers around the country saying, thank God, my students now take an interest in poetry. I pipe the art program into the classroom, and they're enthusiastic about it.
Now, except we must remember that the big networks in those days, Mutual and CBS and NBC, they were commercial networks. They were making money.
That's right.
Then there must have been somebody, the program manager or somebody, who said, wait a minute, we might turn a dollar or two with this guy's crazy poetry idea.
Well, that's quite right. There is a man, an individual, or two or three of them, who set the tone and arrive at a policy and a principle. And that was, I have to thank William S. Paley, And I have to thank Edward R. Murrow, and I have to thank William B. Lewis, who were my backers and promoters, and they did for me what no agent in the world could accomplish. They gave me proprietary titles. That is to say, my name was incorporated in the title. Norman Corwin's Words Without Music was the announcement. And when you have that program carrying your name, you know, I would break every bone in my body to make it as good as I could. And that meant working sometimes all night on a script and revising scripts even during a rehearsal break.
William Paley was the inventor of CBS, and I'm curious to hear you say that Edward R. Murrow, who was the very incarnation of the hard-nosed, hard-boiled newsman, later invented war correspondency, I guess, that he was a supporter of yours, which is on the poetry side of the ledger, on the other side.
Well, that was one of the lucky boons. May I tell you a little incident about Edward R. Murrow?
Please do.
He was at that time, I'm talking now 1938, he was already chief of the European Broadcasting for CBS, stationed in London. But he was home for the holidays. That year, it was 38, my program, Words Without Music, fell on Christmas Day. And I wrote an all-verse piece called The Plot to Overthrow Christmas. I'll give you some idea of its character by rolling off the first few lines. Did you hear about the plot to overthrow Christmas? Well, gather ye now from Maine to the Isthmus of Panama and listen to the story of the utter inglory of some gory goings-on in hell. Now, it happened in Hades, ladies and gentlemen. It happened down there that the fiends held a meeting. The fiends held a meeting for the purpose of defeating Christmas. And so forth, you know. All right. Well, this half hour went on the air, and I was a junior, really, at the network, a freshman. The next morning, there was a knock on the door of my little office, and I opened it, and there stood the handsome Edward R. Murrow, who introduced himself.
Smoking a cigarette, no doubt.
Yes, of course, a cigarette in hand. And he said, Mrs. Murrow and I listened to your broadcast last night, and I just had to come and tell you how much we liked it. That was our introduction. That set up a lifelong friendship.
It was not only English teachers who responded, but Carl Sandburg. He became a big fan of yours during this
period. Oh, yeah. Well, that was another dream fulfilled, because when I was a kid, I was so much influenced by Carl's writing. And I thought, if only I ever could shake that man's hand, if I could meet him one day, little thinking that one day he would be my house guest for a whole month. And I did a program, I adapted Sandburgiana for the stage, for a stage presentation starring Betty Davis. And we toured the country and we played on Broadway, and Carl was beaming and happy and somewhat enriched by it.
You're listening to This Morning, the Sunday edition. My name is Michael Enright. My guest this morning is Norman Corwin. And I have to tell you, he is approaching 90 years old, although you certainly don't sound it, sir.
Well, thank you. I don't think I sound much over 89.
I want to play another excerpt from one of your works. This is the first few minutes of The Odyssey of Runyon Jones. Now, tell me a bit about the creation of this piece.
The Odyssey of Runyon Jones originated when I contemplated the phenomenon of my dog, Nick. I say my dog without license to use that pronoun because it was a neighbor's dog. And I was writing, I was out in the country where I was writing my program per week, and this dog would hear me when I stirred in the morning, and he would come up the hill from his neighbor's house and spend the day with me. And he went everywhere I went. I was quite in love with that dog. And I wanted to do a story about a dog, a little fantasy. And I wrote one about a kid whose dog is run over.
Well, let's hear a bit of it now. The Odyssey of Runyon Jones.
Columbia presents Corwin. Fantasy of Runyon Jones.
Being a fantasy in six scenes and one act with no moral attached. The fifth program, incidentally, of this series. Starring Michael Artist as Runyon. And illuminated by an original musical score composed and conducted by Alexander Semler.
Dogs?
Yes.
I'm looking for my dog.
Your name?
Runyon Jones.
Runyon?
Yes, sir. It's a terrible name, but Mother says I'll like it when I grow up because it's distinguished, she says. The other boys all call me Onion.
What's the name of your dog?
Putsy.
Putsy?
Yes, sir. He's very smart, sir.
When did you meet him?
Yesterday morning.
Where?
Right outside my house. He was chasing an automobile.
Why?
He wanted to bite the tires, I think.
Front or rear?
All of them.
What happened?
The car ran over him.
And then?
He was killed, sir.
Then you're on the wrong floor. This is the Department of Lost Dogs. What you want is the Department of Deceased Dogs.
Where is that, sir?
Two flights up. Here, take this slip and hand it to the man at the desk.
Thank you, sir. Of diseased dogs?
Deceased, not diseased. Let me see that slip.
Yes, sir.
Putsy. You Runyon Jones?
Yes, sir.
Just a minute. Let me look in the file. Jones, J. Orlando, Penelope, Pluto, Putsy Jones. Mm-hmm. 1.5 years old, inveterate auto chaser, leash, attitude.
I don't think there's anything we can do for you.
You can't find Putsy?
Ordinarily, in a good many cases, when a boy's dog dies from old age or natural causes, or is merely run over while chasing a cat in line of duty, or is fatally wounded in a fight with other dogs, we can make arrangements with St. Bernard, the proprietor of Dog Heaven, for the return of the animal on a limited basis.
What's a limited basis?
But in the case of Putsy, he's down in the files as an inveterate auto chaser and tire nipper class 4. Also, it is known that he's resisted leashes, that he bit a dog catcher on August 11th last, and that he stayed out all night on 3 separate occasions. I'm sorry to say he's not in Dog Heaven.
No? Gosh. Are you sure, mister? Couldn't he have snuck in when nobody was looking?
He is not in Dog Heaven, and that settles that.
Well, where is he then?
In the place where all ill-behaved curs are punished. Purgatory.
Purgatory. That elicits an ooh and an ah or a groan, which?
Well, I happen to be one of the past officers of the Punis Association of America, of North America.
Well, it certainly shows.
You know, we have a champion in Shakespeare, and I'm not one of the groaners. But it's perfectly understandable that there are a lot of groanies out there.
Indeed. Now, does Runyon gets his dog back from purgatory? Purgatory,
oh,
I hope.
After many difficulties. I'm not going to give away the ending. No.
You're known for being a fast writer, that you can get the job done quickly. How long would it take you to produce, say, Runyon Jones?
Well,
to bring that off the typewriter.
Michael, those programs came one after the other in a week's time. Yeah, 1 week. I was crazy, you know, because the series, which was called 26 by Corwin, and later Columbia Presents Corwin, again the proprietary title, I used up my lead time, of course, on the first show, and thereafter, the subsequent program, when I left the studio after completing a show, I didn't know what the subject of the next program would be. And that was a crazy kind of a schedule, but I was young and daring and crazy.
You been older, I guess it would scare the hell out of you.
Yeah, that's right. It scares the hell out of me now when I think about it.
At some point, though, the networks, what did they do? They pulled in the reins a bit on your creative freedom. They wanted more commercial stuff, less experimental. Is that right?
Well, yes, but I never got that far, really, because television had come in. Radio, alas, will, I'm afraid, be in the perpetual shadow of television. That is not to say that it still cannot do conscionable work, as you are doing, and as I hope I'm doing in some of my recent productions.
How have you managed over the years to absorb so much? I mean, your work covers so many topics. It's very thought-provoking, that kind of thing, from science to human rights to Shakespeare and literature to Lost Dogs. Do you read a lot, or over the years you're voracious reader, or just sponge this stuff up, or what?
Yeah, I think perhaps my greatest asset in terms of creative work is a curiosity about all life and science and thought and poetry and politics and philosophy. I'm curious and interested, and I happen to be one of those, I guess, old-fashioned romantics who think that just existence is magical. Just being alive, let alone the technical wonders that have me sitting in Los Angeles and you in Toronto over a great distance of this Earth's curvature, talking as though you're in the next room. Yeah. Not in the next room, in the same room. And it's still a source of wonder to me.
I want to play just one more little excerpt. This is from a work called The Undecided Molecule, and the intelligence behind it and the underlying themes are quite amazing, and I want to talk to you about it afterwards. It's about an anonymous molecule named X who is put on trial, actually stands trial, because he refuses to attach himself to matter. Here it is by Norman Corwin, a little bit of The Undecided Molecule.
Where were we in this trial, by the way?
On the right of X to have an open mind. Now, surely justice is not yet so blind as to be unfavorably disposed.
Towards openness of mind, my mind is closed.
Your Honor, this is scandal.
Now, see here, I can handle this. Let's have no more of your bold to do. A molecule must do what it is told to do.
I'm sure that's absolutely true, and that you're not the sort who would deny a prisoner his right to speak in court. Your might is mixed with mercy, and wisdom's interfused. So how about a word or two from X, who is accused?
Oh, very well. Since your appeal is to the better side of me, let no one say my conduct here is prejudiced or snide of me. We'll hear from X, but make it short. Where is the little dope?
Right here beneath this new electronic super microscope.
Swear him in.
Put your right hand on the atomic cable and say as loud as you are able, I do solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and buzz was the muzzawala, buzzawala, hot set, flugo, bugle, putt, putt, scuttle, button, nothing but the truth. So help me, I. Now testify.
What's that squeaking?
My client, speaking.
Well, how do you expect me to understand?
There's an interpreter at hand.
Where? I don't see any.
Right at your elbow.
Oh, yes. How do you do?
I'm very well, Bull.
Bull? Aren't you getting a bit familiar?
I suppose I am, but please think nil of it.
Can you understand what the molecule says?
Yes. That's my business, isn't it?
A fake character.
Like a film by Disney.
Disney's not involved in this.
Why isn't he?
I don't know. Where does all this lead?
Nowhere.
Then please proceed.
Oh, come on. Come on. We're waiting now. The court wants to hear a peep from you.
X says as follows. I cannot bring myself to be just anything that's asked of me. I cannot chide my inner soul. I must confide I've set a goal. I'll fairly bust my heart within if I am just an onion skin. I worry some. What's drearier than to become bacteria? And when I've tried hard to obey, my conscience cried, but hold, but stay. A worm for bait? I have my pride. I vacillate. I can't decide. Though Hamlet had a hard time, why, he wasn't so sad as little I. You see my lot?
Yes.
It's not for me to be or not, but what to be.
Mm-hmm.
My plight inside is bona fide. I can't decide. I can't decide.
Fiddlesticks, this molecule is but a schizophrenic. How is it that in all the time since matter first appeared, each separate iota has loyally adhered to universal law without a solitary beef?
Beef?
Until this pipsqueak came along. Now suddenly there's grief. The heavens shake and earthquakes quake and oceans heave and slither. Dogs and cats and acrobats are in a frightful dither. A timid snip has lost its grip and whines of its neurosis. If you condone this freak, you'll reek of moral halitosis. I strongly urge your honor, purge X to its smallest decimal, or else the infinite will bow before the infinitesimal.
You're right. What was I thinking of to pity Jan Schlemiel? I thought my heart was fairly soft, but it is made of steel. I shall not spoil this molecule by sparing it the rod, and so I sentence it to die before a firing squad.
I ask this sentence be appealed.
Impossible. Your client's fate is sealed.
Ah, no. The court's decision is far from ineluctable. I must remind you, my good sir, that matter's indestructible.
Gadzooks, it is. I had forgot. We can't destroy a particle. It seems we're in the power of this clever young upstarticle.
The case is lost. I must withdraw. If punishment's not capital and X cannot be executed, I don't give a rapital. We can't imprison it, and we'd be in a most infernal stew with cosmic checks and balances eternally askew.
Oh, dear, oh, dear. Vesemir. What will become of all of us? This little Jake and his strange quirk will surely be the fall of us.
Your Honor!
You mean me?
May I have a conference with you at the bench?
Why, of course. May I suggest a means by which disaster be evaded? My client is no pig-head and may likely be persuaded to join some element or other. X is not a softy.
No.
It merely wishes to belong to something fairly lofty. Its point of view is forward. Attitude is global. Its heart is set on being part of something good and noble.
And say the secret word and the duck will come down and pay you. That was Groucho Marx as the judge.
Yes, right.
And Robert Benchley and Vincent Price. Actors must have loved read Corwin's script.
Well, they had a lot of fun. And because of that, because it gave them a chance to take a vacation from the usual fare, they performed for scale. There's a $1 million cast, and,
yeah,
and they cost, I think they got $220 a piece for being on that program.
From July the 18th, 1945. Well, now, we've just turned the new century, a new millennium. You're still working, you're teaching, you're a professor of journalism at University of Southern California. You're reading, writing, thinking. What's your next project?
I haven't really recovered my breath from the last one, and I'm giving myself a little vacation from programming because a new semester starts next Monday at the University of Southern California, and I've got to prepare my syllabus for that.
Are you a tough teacher? Anybody ever get an A from Norman Corwin?
Oh, yeah. I don't believe in that kind of toughness. I think there are plenty of people very well qualified to pick out what's wrong in the student's writing. What's more important to me is to pick out what's right, because sometimes a student doesn't know when he's hit the right note. And even if it's a single right note in a whole sheet of, in a whole page, it's important that he know that he's hit it. It's like knowing that you can ride a bicycle. Once you're able to master that without falling over, you can not ride a bike for 50 years and then get on one and have perfect balance.
Let me ask you just in closing here. You said earlier in the conversation that one half hour of God's own airtime is the most magical thing that one can conceive of. Do you think that radio will ever get back that marvelous quality that it had in the 30s and 40s?
Well, Michael,
the quality that you brought to it, I think.
Michael, you know, never is a long time, and ever is a long time. And I beware of prognosticators. Who knows? We're now at the dawn of a new millennium. All kinds of things can happen. It strikes me that ultimately the listenership and the audiences of the world, the broadcast audiences, may weary of what they're getting on television, explosions and fast cutting and car chases and sex and a lot of bourgeois. Not that there aren't great TV programs, but there certainly is a lot of dross. And I think that while radio may never recover the full power and ubiquity that it enjoyed in the so-called Golden Age, it nevertheless can reach and sustain a higher level of quality than we are getting today. It is rarely that you find a program of respectable depth and girth and seriousness on radio these days. For example, the trade publications like Variety, and they don't even review radio programs now. Yeah. So at the moment, it's a lost art, but it is not permanently lost. It will find its way back. And you can't predict, you know, any more than one was able to predict 100 years ago the marvels of life today and the tastes of life today.
Well, it's a rare privilege to have you on our radio, Mr. Corwin. I thank you so much.
I've enjoyed it.
All the best.
Thank you. The same to you.
Norman Corwin, the 89-year-old writer, producer, and director extraordinaire. He was in the studio this morning in Los Angeles. To hear more of Norman Corwin's programs, you can contact Lodestone in Bloomington, Indiana. Their phone number is area code 812-824-2400, area 812-824-2400, or you can look them up on the web. That's www.lodestone-media.com. When you think about the glory years of radio, it's hard not to think of the music that filled the airwaves in those years. You could tune in almost any time of day and hear the big bands of Tommy Dorsey or Glenn Miller or Benny Goodman, or young singers such as Frank Sinatra. Here is Frank Sinatra from a 1944 broadcast of the CBS program, The Vims Vitamins Show.
Gentlemen of the Armed Forces, this is the hoodlum from Hoboken. I'd like to sing a tune for you. My name's Sinatra, and I hope yous like it, hey.
Long ago.
Frank Sinatra on live radio with the orchestra conducted by Alex Stordal. That's long ago and far away. And speaking of faraway places,